I didn't see anything wrong with it. Go ahead. Start again. I'm going to run out of battery for you.
Okay, that's like 4 seconds before. Scratch that one, Ellen. Hey, Mavity folks. I hope you guys are ready for this one. Not. Don't anybody turn off your video or anything. I am not going to be singing. We just wanted to tell everybody that we miss you tons, and we will be so thrilled when we get together and get to worship and have service together, and hopefully that's soon.
Again?
We miss being with you all at church and love everybody there.
Hope to be back with you all soon.
Hi, everybody. We miss you all.
Yeah, me too. So, see you later.
Love you.
Bye.
Hey, everybody. Miss and love each and every one of you. Be glad when we can get back.
Miss everybody. Love you all. We're all in this together. Love you.
Well, we've had a ball doing this. My producer is just absolutely wonderful. I just want to tell everybody at Mavity, I love them. I miss them. Been praying for them. Can't wait to see everybody. I don't think Brandon's going to get to preach the first service. We'll tear the church apart. And I want to say that I think that Brandon ought to be nominated for Hometown Hero. Love you all.
Love you all too. Have a good day. Bye.
Hey, you all, how are you all doing out there? This is Lovell. That's my wife. You all know her. This is Sandy. And we want to take this opportunity right now to thank each and every one of you that are participating in putting this all together for us people that are home and can't get out very much. And for all these people, Ellen and Brian and Brandon and all of them that sung and everything else, we owe them a great multitude of thank yous, because it's blessed me. I've enjoyed it all. We need you, we love you, and we'll see you back here as soon as the door's open. I'm coming straight in that door, and I'm going to that altar, and I'm thanking God for all of it. I say, Lord.
Amen. It was good to see each and every one that on the video that we haven't seen for some time. We're so thankful today for all that they have said, and it was just good seeing people that we miss. So we thank God for each and every one, and we're going to be doing that a little bit more each and every day. We're going to try to play some testimonies or some things from people, so we hope and pray that you'll look in for that. And if you've got a testimony or if you've got something, send it to Ellen. Send it to Ellen. And if you want to upload a little video, it can't be too long, but just upload a video and maybe give a little shout of praise, and Ellen will take it and she'll put it in on the video. So we look forward to hearing from more and look forward to hearing from you. But that being said, we're going to go ahead and welcome you all out again tonight. We just ask you to reach up and hit your share button. Some of you is getting used to it and have already done it. Hit your share button, get it out to as many people as possible. And then after we have prayer, we're going to go ahead into a song. So let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father God in heaven, we thank you again, Father, for another day. And Lord, we are looking for the time when we can gather back into your house. And Father, we've heard the news media and different people say that we'll never get back to normalcy. And Father, that might not be a bad thing. Lord, that we might not get back to normal as things was before this ever happened. And Lord, we know that when you send us, sometimes you allow us, Lord, I should say, into a trial. Lord, we should never be the same coming out as we was going in. So, Father, I pray that you'd help each and every one work on that little song, He's Still Working on Me. Father, do a work in each and every one's life. And Lord, when we come out of this, we'll not be normal. Father, that we'll exceed normal. Father, most of all, we'll be spiritual people ready to do your work, Father, for we can look around and and see. Lord, there's so much work to be done. Help us all to do our little part for you and for your big glory. God, we love you. We praise you. In Christ Jesus' name we ask. And amen.
Suffer the destroyer or him to come in.
That's right.
Listen to me. If that blood protected them that was in that house that much from God's judgment, how much more do you think the blood of Jesus is going to do? Now you fast forward a little bit farther. That was just one night, right? You might, I'm going to talk a little bit, Dave. That was just one night, okay? But the blood still kept the wrath of the judgment out. Now you fast forward a little bit. And you have a Day of Atonement, Brother Dave, to where they would bring the turtle doves, or they would bring the lamb or the bullock, and they would come in, and the Israel would offer the sacrifice, the Day of Atonement. I know it was a lamb or whatever, the bullock, but they was also sin. Somebody could bring a turtle dove if they wasn't wealthy enough to buy a lamb or a bullock, but they could bring it for their sin offering, and that blood of that lamb, not only for one day, but it would roll those sins throughout that year. It would roll them back. But then, you know what, it would only hold for a year, because the next year, the Day of Atonement, it had to be offered again. Now you look at that. If one lamb for one day could keep the Israelites safe, if one lamb for a whole year could keep the Israelites' sins under that blood, listen to me, from forgiveness for that one whole year, how much more does the blood of Jesus cover? Huh? God said once and for all. Neither blood from the bullocks and all those things from the goats could once and for all do away with sin. Look at the blood of Jesus, that one spotless lamb that God said by John the Baptist. He looked up and said, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the whole world." Listen, not just roll it back for a year, not just for a day, but he taketh away. That means it's like it's never happened before. I'm glad today that the blood of Jesus covers once and for all for my sins and your sins. Listen, I'm trusting the blood. Amen. We're going to move on. I'm telling you, I feel preachy tonight, but we're going to move on. We've got another song about the blood. Larry Keaton's going to be singing, "The Blood Is Still There." I'm so thankful today that the blood is still there. That Satan and all of his demonic hordes and all the storms that he brings, man, Christ's blood, he can't even touch it. He can't even touch it. When his finger gets close, it sizzles. He can't get through the blood. Stay in the blood. All right, we're going to let Brother Larry Keaton come. He's going to sing, and then we'll get into the message. So hope and pray that you got something out of that little hip hip parade that I just gave you.
His father, firstborn son, well,
thank Brother Larry Keaton for that song. The blood is still there. So if you're home tonight and you're in trouble, remember that. The blood is still there. Might have been 2,020 years, but it don't just wash off. Don't just wash off. So that being said, tonight we're going to turn the preacher loose. We've got Brother Dave. Let me tell you how this works. I fully believe that God will show you and God will move you. I had Brother Dave on my heart Tuesday. Maybe it was Monday or Tuesday one. I had Brother Dave on my heart. When I gave him a call, I was out working, doing this and that. And whenever I got time to come into the house, I looked at my phone and Brother Dave texted me. So God knows what he's doing, and we just got to be able to comprehend. So we're going to ask Brother Dave if he would to come and let him give you what God's given him.
Amen. Appreciate it, Brandon.
Amen.
Good evening. It's good to be here again. So thankful to be in the house of the Lord. I know so many of you would love to be here with us, and it's just kind of impossible to do. But one day soon, we're going to be able to be together again. So that's going to be good. Before we get started, I would like to give a shout out. I've got some young ladies that's supposed to be watching tonight. Miss Kay and I have missed them dearly. They're the girls from the Children's Center of Ohio. Hopefully they're out there to be on this and see what we're doing. Also, the boys' home up there that we don't do the ministry there. We have a friend, Brother Gene Wilson, takes care of them. And he can't be with them. And hopefully the boys get to see this too. But girls, I want you to know that Miss Kay and I miss you. We love you.
Amen.
Stay with your Bibles. Some of you ones that's been there longer knows how to do a Bible study. Jump in and do it for us. Tonight we're going to be in the book of Matthew. Brandon said, it's kind of funny how things work out. When I texted him, I was really enjoyed his message the other night from his mom and dad's church. It was just one of them messages that touched my heart. And that's the reason I had texted him. And not that he needs praise, he doesn't care about that at all, but it was just a good message. And I thought a good solid message on what Christians should be doing right now. And the Lord laid this on my heart this weekend, on what we're going to be into. Matthew chapter 24, verse 32. I'm going to read you this, and then we're going to kind of back up. I'll be all over Matthew here for just a second, so kind of bear with us, okay? Starting in the 32nd verse. It says, "Now learn the parable of the fig tree. When its branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, you know that summer is nigh. So likewise, ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the door. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things shall be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away." Let us pray. Father, we come to you again tonight. We're so thankful to be in your house, but we ask you, Father, just as we try to bring this message out in our humble way, we just ask you, Father, that you'd open up hearts and open up minds, that they'd be receptive of this. Father, we're living in times right now, Father, that are uncertain. And we just ask you, Father, just those that are out there lost, that maybe they could hear this. Maybe they would get closer to you and seek you out. For those, Father, who are professing Christianity and just have lost their love, we just ask you, Father, just to bring them back. Hold tight to them, Father. Let them understand what this message is about. And we'll give you all the praise in your Son Jesus' name. And amen. Well, without a doubt, our pastor said earlier that we're not living in normal times, and maybe that was a good thing. And you know, to be honest with you, we're not living in normal times. But as Christians, we're kind of used to that. We're not considered normal anyway. According to the world's eyes, we're not considered normal at all. We're the kind of people that go out here and we praise God and we hug each other and we kiss each other. We shake hands. And that's just not normal for most people now. Jesus laid this on my heart as I was in bed the other night. Now, I tell you what. Because of the times we live in, some people are asking the question, what in the world is going on? What's happening? Why are we in this situation? And I'm going to be honest with you. I give this a lot of thought. And what if? I'm going to give you a what if. What if Jesus is trying to show us that it's not very much longer? What if he's coming down and he's saying, I'm going to slow you down. I'm going to give you time to open up your Bible. And I'm going to give you time to be around your family. And some of you family members who have lost ones in your family that's in your household for the last 4 weeks, maybe you'll be able to get a little closer with them. And as I got to doing this, I thought, well, how can we explain this to someone? What's really going on? What's really happening? And God gives us the answer in this book. Every answer we need to know is right here. Every answer that we should seek is right here. And so he's told us, to understand what the fig tree is, the parable of the fig tree, we got to go back to the first verse in this chapter. I'm going to go through it too real quick. I promise I'm not going to keep you long, but I want you to understand what's going on here. This is not by accident. As a matter of fact, I've been one to say, and I've heard Pastor Brandon say, many preachers say that God didn't cause this virus. But I'm changing my mind on that. God's caused a lot of stuff to get our attention, haven't he? I remember a pharaoh in Egypt that had 10 plagues brought down upon him. It wasn't by accident. God put the plagues on him. I remember a flood in Noah's time that wasn't by accident. It just didn't start raining because of climate warming. It actually started raining because God put the curse on us. And as I look at this, I'm thinking maybe this virus, maybe this sickness that we're seeing, there's other things going on besides this, guys. This isn't the only thing. But maybe he's trying to wake us up. Maybe tomorrow, or maybe the next day, or maybe before we finish this sermon tonight, maybe God's going to come back and take his church home. What an amazing thing to think about, but what a sad thing for some of us. Chapter 24, verse 1. Just going to read a few verses here. It says, and Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the building of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all of these things? Verily I say unto you that there shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? What shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto him, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and shall deceive many. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, and see that it is not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines, pestilence, and earthquakes in diverse places. Let's stop right there. Let's look at this. Before we get to the parable of the fig tree, the reason we was there is because of the questions that the disciples asked. The disciples asked these questions because Jesus had just come out of this big temple. I haven't seen a picture of the temple. They tell me from what I've read about it was one of the most magnificent things you've ever seen. And as the disciples come out with Jesus, they say, I want you to stop and look at this, Jesus. I want you to look how beautiful this is. You know, we do that today. You know, we kind of stop to admire the beautiful stuff and the stuff we've seen around. As we look at this, Jesus said, hey, don't be too excited about this. It's not going to be too long. That there's going to be one rock on top of another. Now, if you've studied your Bible at all, you know this happened about 70 AD whenever the temple was destroyed. But Jesus then goes on, he's sitting on the Mount of Olives, and the disciples are asking him this question. They asked him, he said, tell us something. When are these things going to be? I'm going to tell you something right now. Jesus doesn't leave us cold on when he's coming back. We got to understand that we're in that time right now. I'm going to show you why here in just a second. But they want to know when this thing shall be, and when shall be the sign of thy coming, and the end of the world. And we got to understand something. The rapture and the end of the world, that's two different things. I mean, we got the second coming 7 years after the rapture. And I know that there's pre-raptures, there's mid-trap raptures, and there's post-raptures. And if you believe that, God bless you. I'll just meet you in heaven, okay? I'll be waiting for you up there. But it doesn't matter. That's not a salvation issue for me. So it doesn't really matter. But I want you to look at this. Before Jesus Christ said anything, before he talked about wars and rumors of wars, before he said anything about any kind of pestilence or famines, he said, I want you to take heed that no man deceive you. Meaning, don't let man deceive you. What are we seeing today? Men are deceiving one another all over the place. We are getting people today in our churches. I have nothing against certain pastors, but I'm telling you something. Whenever you're getting up there and you're not telling the truth and you're not preaching the gospel, you've got a problem. Whenever our kids are going to college and they're being told stuff that's not true, you got a problem with that. That's deceiving. You know, people will tell you right now that there could be no way that the earth was made in 6 days and on the seventh day they rested. We're told that it's impossible to do. By the man who spoke this into existence, we're saying that he couldn't do that. And unfortunately, we have pastors in the pulpit today that are amen in that. They're saying, you know what, we'll make it fit. We'll make it work. You know, if they want to tell us that it's a million years old, we'll make that work. Remember the old scripture that says, a day's like a thousand years and a thousand years is like a day. Doesn't have nothing to do with this. 6 days the earth was made. Six 24-hour days. And on the seventh day, he rested. We see people today telling you that Christ's death on the cross, it wasn't for everybody. There's preachers today preaching that the Christ's death on the cross was just for an elect few. Mm-hmm. Not for all of us, but just for you. My Bible tells me something completely different.
Amen.
It said, for God so loved the world, not just a few of you, for God so loved all of us, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. You got to believe in it. That's only speculations. You know, this Matthew 24 is a chapter of, or is a book of, and chapter of prophecy, but it's showing us what's coming. Just like Romans chapter 10 tells us how to be saved, this is telling us how we can actually have to know when Jesus Christ is coming back. He said, for many shall come in my name and say that I am the Christ. We see that all over the place. We see that all over the place. So don't let man deceive you. It's very important. We go on here, wars and rumors of war. We know that's there. We've seen that all over the place. There's wars everywhere. But then it goes on ahead down here, and it speaks against famines. You know, there's a locust plague right now in the Middle East and all through Northern Africa that they say is going to be terrible as far as the famine goes. The food shortages is going to be unreal. There's locusts. This is biblical. You know, this is what happened with one of the plagues. You know, you got to understand something. This is something we don't see every day. It talks about earthquakes in diverse places in another part of the book, in another part of the Bible. This earthquakes, I just read yesterday that I think it was California last month had over 600 earthquakes. Something's going on. You talk about birth pains? Something terrible is going on. Something good for us Christians, terrible for the lost, I'm telling you. Famines and pestilence. Pestilence, what are we talking about? We're talking about the locusts, famines, or we're also talking about this coronavirus. This isn't the only virus. I read the other day where there's like 10 other viruses out there that's killing people, that's hurting us. God is trying to wake us up, church, I'm telling you. He's trying to wake us up. He's telling us that this is only the beginning of sorrows.
That's right.
What is the beginning of sorrows? It's like birth pains. Sorrows is whenever the tribulation starts, what we're about to get into in the tribulation. I'm going to be honest with you. If we can only tell and show you how bad the tribulation is going to be,
amen,
I believe the churches would be filled today.
Amen.
But yet we're sitting here today and we're saying it's never going to happen. It's kind of like us dying, isn't it? We know we're going to die, but everybody thinks it's not going to happen to them. It's the most amazing thing to me as I watch people. Everybody's going to get this coronavirus but us, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like God's got our mind. He's made our mind so great that we know we're going to die. We know it's told that we're going to die. But yet we don't think it's going to happen to us. As a matter of fact, we do things stupid that shouldn't be done. We go out into the world. We think we got plenty of time. You know, there's several people that in the last few months have passed away that I know that didn't have that extra minute to accept Christ as Savior.
That's right.
They didn't have that extra second like they thought they was going to have. And I'm telling you something, you can't wait long enough, you can't wait to get yourself right with the world. You can't say, I'm going to stop my drinking, my drugging. You can't do that and say, I'll be with Jesus tomorrow, but today I want to take care of this. You come to Jesus, he'll take care of the rest of this stuff. You don't have to worry about this. So then we look over at the parable of the fig tree. What is this? What is the parable of the fig tree? Verse 32 tells us, if you've done any Bible study at all, most Bible scholars will tell you, and I'm definitely not one, that when you talk about a fig tree, we're talking about Israel. And we know as we look through this that the Israel we're talking about is the one who has came back in 1948. May 14th, actually. We're almost at an anniversary for their return, which is amazing to me. It'll be 72 years coming up in May 14th, 2020. So let's look at this for just a second. He's talking about the return of the Jews back to Jerusalem. He's talking about the nation of Israel becoming a nation again. I've got it broken down here so I didn't have to look it up real quick. Isaiah 66 tells us in verse 8. He says, who hath heard such things? Who hath seen such things? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once? For soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth her children. This was prophesied by Isaiah hundreds of years before it happened. That Israel would become a nation. It would not take months or years to do. That in one day that this would happen. And I'm telling you something. One of the most exciting things to me is to see this happen. We're living biblical prophecy. Every time I see something in the Bible, on the news, I look in the Bible.
Right.
And it seems like there it is. There it is. There's a wonderful thing. But he tells us. He tells us when this is going to happen. The Bible goes on in Matthew, tells us that this generation shall not pass away before all these things come to pass, before the rapture, before the coming of Jesus Christ. And the coming of Jesus Christ is going to be after the seven-year tribulation. Remember that. Now, somebody says to me, well, that's good. 100 years is a generation. We know what a generation is. It's 100 years, maybe 200 years. People have no idea. But I got to thinking about this. And I looked this up in the book of Psalms in chapter 90. In verse 10, it says, the days of our years are 80 years and 10. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength labored in sorrow. For it is soon cut off and fly away. So 1 score is 20. So we're looking at 70 years. That's what God's promised us. And he said, by their strength you may get 80 years. We may get 80 years. Some people live, they say, well, what about the ones that die at 20? What about the ones that die at 30? That just happens. You know, that's just part of it. God has promised us that we would have 70 years, 80 years possibly. So that is a generation. I look at that as a generation. And I did a little bit of math. And I can tell you this, me and Pastor Brandon aren't the best math people in the world. We've had this discussion several times about another subject. But I can also tell you this.
He was wrong, Dave.
I was wrong, he was right. But if we look at it this way, if we look at next year being the 73rd year of the return of the Jews to Israel and the nation being born again, that means there's 7 years left for the 80th year. Mm-hmm. I'm not a time seven. I'm not saying this. He could come tonight, and you know, I would be grateful if he did, to be honest with you. A lot of family members are out there lost. But if you think about this, we have a 7-year tribulation. And 7 is a big number for Jesus. I mean, this is something, they call it the number of completion point, because he completed his work on earth in 7 days. But what happens? What if, and this is another what if, not a hypothetical actually, because it's going to happen. I'm just not telling you when it's going to happen. You know, the Bible tells us in John 14, he says, listen, I'm going to tell you these things now. He's telling his disciples. He was talking about his death. He said, I'm telling you these things so that when it happens, you will believe. Mm-hmm. All right? When it happens, you're going to be able to understand this. We're telling you this today. Amen. He's showing us this today so that when this happens, when you see these things coming, these viruses, these floods, look at the floods we had down south this weekend. Look at the storm we had the other night. It was a dandy. I'm here to tell you. Where I lived, it was a dandy. Look at all this stuff that's going on. People losing their lives. For no reason, just out there, people kill them. This world is waxing worse and worse and worse. And Jesus said, I'm not going to let this happen. We're not going to have to go through this. If you believe for 1 second that this earth is not worse than it was back in Noah's days, I got a thing to tell you that. I'm telling you what, it was Noah, of course, there wasn't as many people around, but I don't think Noah seen anything like we're seeing today. And God destroyed that. He destroyed that. And you know what people said? For 120 years, people said, hey, look at old Noah. Look how dumb he is. He's building a boat out in the desert. And what for? There's nothing around to float. That's what they told him. They're scoffers. 2 Peter tells us about scoffers, doesn't it? He said those would be scoffing, and they'll say, where is the promise of his coming?
Amen.
I've heard that myself in the last 2 weeks. Wait, if you said that he's coming back, I've heard my whole life. He's not back yet. I said, look at 2 Peter. You just fulfilled Bible prophecy.
Amen.
You just fulfilled it with his words. We got to understand something. God has promised us that his word is true. He cannot lie.
Amen.
He's promised us that he would not leave us ignorant on when he's coming back. But we got to open up our eyes. Quit thinking. Quit watching the news. Quit listening to these people when they're telling you how bad things are. Stop sitting there thinking, well, people... We had a mayor in New York City the other day say God had nothing to do with the people being
the governor,
well.
You were right.
with the people getting well in New York City. He came right out and said it on TV. God had nothing to do with it. He said, we did it. Let me think what happens when you're proud like that. I believe God punishes it, doesn't he? He punishes the proud. There's no doubt about that. But the good news is, God's given us a way out. He's given us a way out, guys. This is all going to happen, and it's going to happen sooner than later. I've said this many times, and I don't care to say it 100 more times. This is going to happen in my lifetime. I believe with all my heart this is going to happen soon. And I don't know the date, don't know the hour, I'm not saying that, but I believe it's going to happen soon. And what's going to happen to you? What's going to happen to you whenever God calls us, whenever he says it's time to go, and he takes his elect, or he takes his church, and he takes him to heaven, and those who are dead in Christ, the grave shall bust open, and we get to meet them in the air. I'm going to tell you something about the tribulation, and then I'm going to close up here. Let me tell you something about tribulation. You don't want to be there.
Amen.
You do not want to be there. You think it's bad. We have 130,000 dead in the United States, or I'm sorry, around the world today. Look at Revelation chapter 9.
One third of the
population. Exactly right. In Revelation chapter 9, I believe it's the sixth trumpet. One third of the population. Now, there's 7 billion, almost 8 billion people in the world. Let's say, for argument's sake, that half of those go in the rapture, and that's not even going to be close. Nowhere will there be half going in the rapture. Do you realize that's a million? Again, that's great for me and Brandon. 1,333,000 people, I'm sorry, 1,333,000 people that's going to leave in a moment's time, that's going to die. And we're going crazy over 130,000 worldwide. I'm going to tell you something. It's going to be an awful, awful, awful thing. Bible tells us you're going to pray that the rock shall fall on you. Just to get rid of it. Just to get you out of your miseries. I don't want anybody to see that. I don't want my family members to see this. I don't want the people in this church to see this. Their family members, their husbands and their wives who refuse to come and refuse to accept Christ as their Savior. I don't want to see that. I want to be able to look right now and look at people and say, I want you to follow me. I want you to go with me to heaven. That's how simple it is. All you got to do is ask and repent of your sins, because God has given us a way out. Luke chapter 21 tells us, and when these things begin to come to pass, he said, then look up and lift your heads, for your redemption draws nigh.
Amen.
When you see this stuff coming on, when you see all these things coming about, instead of being scared, instead of running and hiding, open up your Bible. This is our problem today, guys. I'm going to be honest with you. This is our problem today. Church members, this is your problem today.
Amen.
This is your problem today. I'm one of these guys that when Brandon preaches or anybody preaches, and I'm sure Brandon does it to me too, but when anybody preaches, if he says something that I have not heard, or something that I'm thinking is a little messed up, Bible says to show you, study to show yourself approved.
Right.
I look it up. I check him out. Why do I do that? It's not to make him feel bad if I say something, but I'm supposed to correct him.
Right.
If something is wrong, he said something wrong, he don't want to say something wrong, guys. I was corrected about 8 years ago, I'll never forget it. I was teaching a class at the boys' home up in Ohio, Patriot, Ohio. And I said, you know, Noah got on the boat with seven people. There were seven total people on the boat with him. This little boy, this big. He said, no, sir, there was eight. And I said, son, I'm sorry. You know, I'm the preacher here. I think you're wrong. And he brought the Bible to me, and he showed me. I didn't mind being corrected. As a matter of fact, I appreciate it. We need to pick this up. You need to know what's going on. The only way you're going to know what's going on is if you know what this book says. What are you going to do if your loved one comes and said, hey, tell me how to get saved. What do I do? And you haven't studied to show yourself approved. You sit there and start stammering. You can't do this, guys. Church members, we need to know this book. Or we need to know. I'm not one of those that can memorize verses. I have tried. Lord knows I've tried. I pray. It just ain't happening for me. But in my mind's eye, it's like when someone says, where's the verse that says this? I know where it's at, located in my Bible. It's in the left corner, it's in the middle of the Bible. I know where the page is. I know what part it's in. God has given me that ability that I can go and pick it out and read it to you. So tonight, as we close up, as we get ready to finish this night's service, I'm going to invite you to do something. I never want to leave a service without inviting you to accept Christ as your Savior. And tonight is the most important night in your life. We don't know that we have tomorrow. We don't know that we have the next 5 minutes. But I'm going to say this to you, that this is the most important thing that you and young people especially, listen to me. This is the most important thing you'll ever do in your life. Not your college pick, not who you're going to marry, not what kind of house or what kind of car you're going to buy, but are you going to accept Christ as your Savior? We've got some college kids in the churches in the area, I'll put it this way, who was faithful members, came to their churches, and we don't see them much anymore. And one of the reasons is they get into college, and believe me, been there, done that. They get into a different lifestyle, and they learn that there's other things out there. And they find out that their friends and their professors don't believe in Christ. They call them Jesus freaks. They talk about him. And then they come home for a break and we never see him. Let me tell you something, young people. Without a doubt, you're the generation that's going to suffer for this. You're the ones who will be left in the tribulation. You're the ones that's going to be left behind. Don't let that happen to you. You're not that tough. You can't make it through it. I can promise you this. The Holy Spirit's going to be gone. There's nothing there. Tonight, I'm going to ask you just to, before we get ready to close up, I'm going to pray here. I'm going to ask you just, no matter where you're at, just get on your knees. You don't have to speak out loud. You can do it in your heart. Most of us, that's the thing we did when we come to the altar. We was crying so hard we couldn't speak anyway. We just, Lord, we're sinners. And that's all we have to do is say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I'm asking you tonight to release me of that sin. Release me of that burden. Come into my heart tonight. And he's promised us that he will do that. So let's have prayer. Do me a favor. Brandon's phone number's on the bottom of these videos. For my friends and family, if you don't want to call our pastor, my phone number is 740-237-0227. I ain't doing nothing else. Sitting home with my wife, and she's getting me. So let's have prayer right now. Just ask God into your hearts, and then we'll turn it back over. Father, we come to you. We know there's people out there watching this, Father, who don't know you as Savior. We know people. There's people out there, Father, that are scared. They're confused about what's going on. We got to let them understand, Father. Show them, Father, that you are the way, the truth, and the life. That through you, all this can be settled down. You don't have to worry about death. We know that this stuff's out there, that there's famines, there's viruses, there's plagues, there's all kinds of stuff. I don't fear this, Father, because I know that if I get to go home, if I pass it tomorrow, that I get to go to heaven. We ask you, Father, just to understand and listen to each and every prayer that's out there today. As they bow their head in front of this TV, as they bow their head, Father, and they ask God into their hearts, we just ask you to honor and give them the glory for that. We thank you, Jesus. We love you. Give you all the praise in your son Jesus' name, and amen. We'll turn this back over to our pastor.
I just got something short. Did you hear that tonight? Some of you like, did I hear it? I heard the message. No, did you hear it? The burden.
Yeah.
The burden.
Yeah, it is.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what makes the preaching, is the burden that you have. And I'm telling you, we're seeing that burden all across the land. And people are preaching, listen, we are the generation.
Amen.
We're not going to pass till we see the Lord coming. So I thank Brother Dave for that message. But most of all, I thank him for the burden that I have witnessed tonight. Don't die lost. You do not have to die lost.
That's right.
Hell was not made for you. Hell was made for the devil and his angels. Don't go there, okay? Go to heaven. Heaven was prepared for you. The way was made for you. Go to heaven. So take what he said, apply it to your heart. Call me. Call him, text him. Reach out. We'll do whatever we can. So we love you today. We pray that God blesses you. And we'll see you again, Lord's willing, tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. So we say bye-bye to you.